Hi, my name's Amber. I was asked to do a video for this project, so I'm gonna share my story about how Rich Mullins has impacted my life. His music has actually been in my life since the day I was born. My dad has always played Rich's music throughout my whole life, even when I was in the hospital after being born for quite some time. I don't even know if I can express in words what his music has done for me or how helped me throughout life, but words are hard. But his music has been my stepping stone since as long as I can remember. The song that got me through a lot of stuff, Let Mercy Lead, I still listen to this day, and the music and his ministry and what he shared is just absolutely mind-boggling. I don't understand how one measly guy made such an impact 25 years later, but I guess here we are and it's still going on. So it's really neat to see, because nowadays ministries and people and stuff like that, they don't have this impact on people. And I don't know, even his music nowadays is more, how will you word it, impactful and meaningful, even more so nowadays. His lyrics just speak of worldly things happening today, and it's absolutely amazing. But his music has definitely been in there. So one thing that has really messed me up in my life, my dad told me a story a few years back that when I was born, I had some difficulties after I was born, and I was in the hospital for a few weeks. I don't exactly know how long, but I was left into the ICU, and he would come visit me every day. And when I was born, his first words to me, so he says, was, "Welcome to America. You'll come to love it here, but you'll never belong here." And it kind of fits my description of life. I don't have a home here. I don't know. I never feel at home in this world, and I feel like that's probably part to do with it. But his music has definitely shaped who I am today, and I'm so thankful to my father for instilling in me to listen to Rich Mullins, because his music is just revolutionary, even 25 years later. I mean, he was an amazingly talented musician, an amazing minister. He did an amazing ministry. That's better wording. And I don't know. He's important in my life. Never met the guy. He was gone before I was born. But I don't know. I like it. I like his music to this day, and I still listen to it. So, Rich Mullins, I would say that his music has been the guidance of my life to help me get a better relationship with Jesus and a better understanding of Christianity, if you even want to call it that. But I'm thankful for it, and I'm happy to be a part of this video and share what may not make sense to anybody else, but makes sense to me, how he's shaping my life. So, yeah, I even got to meet some of the band members here and there, and as I go along in life, I'm finding out that more of his music means a lot. It helps me through a lot, so I'm very thankful for that. And his music has helped me through a lot of rough times in my life, and it continues to help me through the bad, the good, whatever comes my way. I have his music, and I don't know, that's about it.
Came to Christian when I was 12 years old, up in the Boundary Waters canoe area here in Minnesota with my youth group. When I was a sophomore in high school, I became part of a kicking off a Christian singing group with Youth for Christ. We went around to different churches and youth groups, and I got to present the gospel in that group quite often. And Rich's music, we got to sing a few of his things back then. And I remember going to the Christian bookstore and looking around and pulling this guy off the shelf and taking that home, and it just, I was just amazed by it, and I absolutely loved it. So I went back and got this one and came to the song about First Family and realized Rich was from Indiana. And even though I'm from Minnesota, all of my extended family is from Indiana. And so when I heard specifically him talk about Indiana clay and how his dad had worked the Indiana clay, that's what my grandparents did and what my dad grew up doing. And so to hear stories, I would hear stories about that, about him doing that on the farm. And also very thankful that I didn't grow up on the farm as well. So with that, and so in high school, Rich was very much a part of my faith. I been musical since the age of five, and so I played violin from the age of five on. About eight or nine, started playing piano. That same year, I became a Christian. I started writing my own stuff on there, and music was always been a part of that. So Rich was always there through the thick and thin of it growing up. And when I was 18, I prayed this other prayer to ask God, realized that he was not, even though he was my savior, he wasn't necessarily in control of my life. And so I said, God, would you become king of my life? Would you become the Lord of my life? And so I prayed that prayer, went off to school, and immediately it was just like this, the Holy Spirit was just speaking to me, going, hey, am I Lord over here? Is this area, you know, poking at me? What about over here? Is this, can I mess around with that area of your life? And it was just constantly being convicted here and there about things, and then just struggling in my faith. Is what I did it at the age of 12 real? And that's when this album came out, Liturgy, Legacy, and a Ragamuffin Band, and it was exactly what I needed to hear. I needed to hear songs that spoke to the sin in my life, like Hold Me, Jesus. Are you king of my, you've been king of my glory, would you be my Prince of Peace? And then also just hearing Rich scream out, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I needed to hear those words in that time. Fast forward to later on, worked through some of those things, owned my faith for the first time. Remember praying with my wife, or my wife to be my fiance at the time. God, would you just make me a man after your own heart? And and that was just kind of my recommitment time, a recommitment time in my life. And I also remember a time when I was coming home from my fiance's family's house, from her folks' house, and coming back into the Twin Cities and coming up 35W where it meets 94 on a Sunday evening, and hearing the news that Rich had passed. And I just, in the car there, just started bawling, just started crying, because he had been so influential in my life. So I never got to see Rich. I got to see him once at a festival, but I had forgotten my tickets. So there was a stage, the sea of people, a field, and then a fence way back there, and I got to see him from back there. So it wasn't a very great experience, and he didn't talk a whole lot. So it wasn't a true Rich Mullins experience at that point. But after his passing, he, content just started kind of pouring out, and I would just grab onto all sorts of stuff I could, from CDs upon CDs to videos to magazines, so whatever I could get my hands on. People seeing if I could get copies of concerts that he did, and so I would just listen to his stuff and just take it in. Well, being newly married, I didn't think it was wise to take my wife out on the road. Like I had always kind of planned to do, and being a Christian musician. And I don't think she was too keen on it anyway. So I became a worship pastor right at the kind of the height of the modern worship movement, right after Rich's passing a few years later. And which was a great experience. And then fast forward many years to the movie on his life. And I remember sitting down with my wife and watching it and being just kind of taken aback, because I didn't realize that Rich had struggled so much with his demons, with the demons in his life. When Ragamuffin, when Liturgy, Legacy, and a Ragamuffin Band came out, I was in seminary at the time, and so I got to read Brendan Manning's Ragamuffin Gospel, and it was awesome. It was great. And so I kept up on his stuff, and, you know, a couple of years before the movie on Rich's life came out, Brendan put out his last biography, just talking about up to the time where he had, you know, help in taking care of him. I think he had some strokes or something, and so he needed some in-home care. His biography was saying, hey, he struggled with alcohol up to the time that he needed help in his home. And that just really hit home for me. Just inside, and my heart was just asking, you know, God, how can these two guys who, man, influence probably millions of people around the world, how can they follow you and still struggle with these demons? And that was pretty hard to take. But yet at the same time, as I'm asking those questions, I'm dealing with these other big demons in my own life and that I really struggled with. And it wasn't until I came back to Rich's stuff this past year, after dealing with those demons in my life and humbling myself and reaching out and asking some folks for help and getting into a group and getting into some counseling that I realize, as I'm listening to Rich again, it is only by the grace of God that we are saved. It is only by His power that, one, we get to live each day of this life, and it's only by His grace that we can overcome. So whether we're, you know, made perfect in the next life or are able to get over struggles in this life, it's only by His grace. And so I'm very thankful. These days, so I came out of full-time ministry about 5 years ago, and was about that time that I was really kind of struggling with those things in my life. But it brought me to asking questions about the church and why do we do church the way we do. And it led me to house church stuff. It led me to doing some discipleship things. And so for the last 5 years, I've been really digging into what it means to be like one-on-one engaging people with the gospel. And I'm actually back at a church part-time as a worship leader, but it's at a church that wants to do discipleship. It is one that wants to engage people, lost people, with the gospel. And I'm so excited to be a part of that and to help others, through song especially, inspire them to share their story of how God transformed their life and how they can express the gospel to lost people. So, so to this day, I love singing songs and sharing that. I think a lot of that foundation came from Rich.
Times my life just don't make sense at all. When the mountain seems so big and my faith just seems so small. So hold me, Jesus, 'cause I'm sure. so hot inside my soul. Swear there must be blisters on my heart. So hold me, Jesus, 'cause I'm shaking like a leaf. You have been king of my glory. Won't you be my Prince of Peace? So hold me, Jesus, 'cause I'm shaking like a leaf. You have been king of my glory. Won't you be my Prince of Peace? I'm singing, hold me, Jesus, 'cause I'm shaking like a leaf. You have been king of our glory. Won't you be our Prince of Peace?
And you know what? What I think is scary about God is He didn't come up with any plan B. That He left the church here, and the church is the only group of people, and the church is the only institution in the world that can bring about a change.
Searching for glory, and He showed us a cross. Now we know our love is.